Hi, my name is Mateusz Chochol. I have a pleasure and honor to present our keynote of the Copernicus Festival. Joel Pearson is a professor of cognitive neuroscience at the University of South Wales in Sydney. He is founder and director of Futures Minds Lab, a multidisciplinary research group that both do multidisciplinary research on mind and cognition and consult companies and designers on brain science and human-computer interactions. His research focuses on human consciousness, imagination, intuition, and many other cognitive capacities of human being. Professor Pearson is involved also in so-called translational cognitive neuroscience, namely translating scientific findings to helping individuals in the clinic. Today, Professor Pearson will talk about human imagination. Thank you again. Joel, floor is yours.
Well, thank you for that great introduction. It's a pleasure to almost be there. I wish I could be there with you, but in these times, it just wasn't possible. But yeah, it's an honor, and I'm very happy for the invitation. And I hope I can offer some insights and interesting things about the human imagination, mental imagery, and aphantasia. So let me start by just asking everyone who's listening to this, if you think about what an apple looks like. So you think about what an apple looks like. You try and imagine an apple. Do you have a conscious experience of that apple? Do you see its shape? Do you see its colors? Maybe it's a green apple, maybe it's a red apple. What do you actually experience? And if you are experiencing something, not everyone does, as we'll get to shortly, that's what I'm talking about with visualization or mental imagery. The word imagination has taken on lots of different meanings, from creativity through to visualization and even other things. But today we'll be mostly focusing on this visualization capacity, this visual mental imagery. And one of the reasons I love visual imagery so much is it's this ability that a lot of us have to create our own worlds, like a virtual reality engine, if you like. You know, we can create things that have never existed. We can predict what's going to happen tomorrow. I can predict this talk, practice it in my mind's eye, practice it over and over, or I can think about what I did yesterday or last year or the year before. So it lets us sort of simulate all these rich sensory events. And it turns out that's a huge part of life for most of us, but not everyone, as we'll see. So where I often, almost always start off with, when we're talking about these dimensions of the human mind, these very personal experiences of inside our head, inside our mind, how do we measure these things, right? It's not always easy and it's not always obvious. So this has been one of the big challenges of psychology and neuroscience. How do we measure the human mind? And one of the common ways is to just talk to someone. Got you to imagine the apple. I could sit down with you and you could imagine an apple and we could talk about it. We could do an interview. You could tell me what it was like to visualize and imagine that apple. Unfortunately, when we do that, lots of things can, if you like, interfere with those data. The way I talk to you, the way I'm dressed, all kinds of things can bias the data. Another way might be to design a questionnaire. And there are questionnaires for mental imagery, for the imagination. And that's sort of a step, if you like, in a more objective direction. But again, there are lots of other things that can also bias a questionnaire. So what I've been trying to do for many years now, what we've been doing here at Future Minds Lab, is trying to figure out ways to measure the human mind objectively and reliably. So we look at this slide here, and we sort of see on one side, you see the human brain inside the skull, right? And the research into the wetware of our brains, of the neurons, you know, everything from the research going to the genetics to change how neurons respond and act through to the AI and machine learning algorithms we now use for brain scanning. There's just been these huge developments in that side of the field, on this side of the equation, if you like. On the other side here, looking at the mind, the advances haven't been anywhere near so much. right? We're still faced with this challenge of how do we measure the human mind? How do we measure these internal private experiences? So what I guess I'm getting at is we kind of want something like a microscope to measure the mind, if we use the analogy from biology, or a blood test to measure the mind. How can we measure things that are inside and private objectively and reliably? And that's really one of the passions of mine and the lab here. And so I want to talk a bit about how we measure mental imagery, visual imagery here in the lab. So my journey, my personal journey with studying the imagination with mental imagery started when I was programming an experiment many, many years ago, probably 2006 or seven. And I was looking at these, what are called ambiguous bistable figures here in this slide. And they're bistable, they're ambiguous. So if you look at the one on the bottom left there, you'll see the vase in the center and the two silhouetted faces. And you either see the vase or the faces, and your perception alternates back and forward. Likewise, if you look at the wireframe cube there, the perspective and the way you see the cube will flip and alternate. And it'll just keep doing that back and forward as you look at it, as will the other two, the old lady, young lady illusion. So these are called ambiguous or bistable percepts or perception. And there's something called binocular rivalry, which is probably, I think, the most interesting or most exciting version of these bistable ambiguous figures. So the easiest way to demonstrate binocular rivalry, it's not quite the full thing, but if you put your hand up in front of one of your eyes, just one, you're putting your visual system into a state of rivalry. So binocular to ocular rivalry. So one eye is seeing the hand, the other side is probably looking at the screen and looking at me. So your brain is sort of forced with trying to blend together these two very, very different images. And it can't do that, right? It can do that when things are just a little bit different and we see three-dimensional depth. But when they're very different, we can't do that. And if we were to equate the brightness of those two images, your hand and my image, what you'd see is these beautiful oscillations or vacillations between the two, between the screen and the hand. In fact, your awareness will just switch back and forward. So here's a little video of that, of what it might look like. And here's a sort of mocked up binocular rivalry display with a red and a green pattern with different orientations. So we're just trying to make those as different as possible. And literally what you'll see is you'll see the green pattern and the red pattern, and your awareness will go back and forward. And this has been a really popular and exciting tool to study awareness and consciousness in its own right. But I was playing around with this back in 2006 and seven. And for some unknown reason to me now, I decided to see what happens if I imagine one of these patterns. If I imagine, say, in this case, a green pattern or a red pattern before I turn on this so-called binocular rivalry illusion. All right, so here's a little demonstration of what that could look like. So I imagine the green pattern, let's say. So 5 seconds, imagine that. Then I stop and have a rest, and there's different ways you can do this. And then all I do is flash on this binocular rivalry illusion. And the question is, how, if at all, is what I imagine going to affect what I see in binocular rivalry? In other words, is the content of my imagery going to bias my perception in this binocular rivalry illusion? And it turns out that it does. Turns out what you imagine, if you imagine green, like in this little video here, and I flash on binocular rivalry, there's a higher probability you'll see green. If I imagine red, then I'm more likely to see red. So there's a positive bias or a priming effect, you can call it. What I tend to imagine is what I'll tend to see. This was really exciting at the time because it was a way to tap into what's going on privately in my mind to measure what I'm imagining, right? And so we can quantify this. If you're just imagining a red or green thing, there's two patterns, so chance is going to be around 50%. And anything above that, any bias above that, is going to sort of show me how much or how often my imagery biased this visual illusion. And the higher that bar, the stronger my sensory imagery. And through many, many experiments over the last sort of 11 or 12 years, we've shown that, in fact, imagery functionally behaves a lot like weak perception. Right? And we know that through other brain imaging methods that there's a lot of activity in visual cortex. Things are happening there when you imagine. So functionally, it seems to be like when you're imagining, if you have imagery, then It's almost like, not exactly the same as seeing a very, very degraded and weak stimulus. So, what does this tell us? It tells us, one, that what we imagine can literally change the way we see the world, right? What I imagine will change how I see the world. It changes my visual perception, which is pretty cool and exciting in itself, right? But also, as time went on, we realized that using this method was really the first objective and reliable way to measure mental imagery. We didn't need to do a questionnaire. We didn't need to use an interview. In fact, you don't need to ask people directly about their mental imagery. We can use the binocular rivalry illusion and ask them about that, and that will indirectly measure visual imagery. Right? So it's kind of like, right, we're approaching this microscope for the mind, this microscope for the imagination. Right? We're starting to get a bit more objective here. One of the things that are objective, we can start scientifically examining them. We can look at the brain mechanisms, we can look at this, and we can look at that. So here's just a very quick summary. I can't go through sort of 12 years of research, but we've shown lots of different things using this method. We've shown that how vivid my imagery feels is related to this sensory strength measure. Another way to put that is we have good metacognition of visual imagery. We've shown that imagery is different to visual attention, and we can differentiate those in a few different ways. This is a very technical point. We've shown that imagery is local in visual space. It's orientation specific, and it obeys a bunch of laws that visual perception also obeys. We can disrupt visual mental imagery with bright lights, with a bright background. Imagery is not as strong. And we figured out a way to measure the capacity limits of imagery, the capacity limits of the imagination. So as you imagine more and more different things, your imagery gets weaker and weaker. So it has fairly strict capacity limits. We've done a whole series of experiments looking at visual cortex, the sort of part of your brain back here, and shown that when imagery is stronger, people tend to have a smaller visual cortex. We've also been linking visual imagery with other cognitive functions like working memory, short-term memory. We've shown that if you have imagery, you'll tend to use it for short-term working memory. If you don't, as we'll see in a subsequent experiment with aphantasia, then you do it a very different way. And we've been looking at the functional brain mechanisms of imagery as well, things like cortical excitability. And we've shown using brain stimulation, we can actually increase or decrease visual imagery strength in the normal population. So if you already have imagery, we can up or down regulate to using a type of brain stimulation. And we've also been playing around with voluntary, involuntary types of imagery. And we'll come back to that a bit later. And I think it's safe to say now that there's something called the imagery debate. And if you haven't heard of that, that's fine. It's this debate that went on for about 40 years. And I think it's one of the longest, if not the longest, debate in science between two camps that were saying imagery is depictive and pictorial, like pictures literally back here in the brain. And the other sort of side saying, no, imagery is strictly symbolic and propositional, like words. And I think there's just so much evidence now that imagery can indeed be depictive and pictorial. So I want to move on now to aphantasia. And so, as this little animation just showed, the mind's eye there is blacked out, it's blind. So aphantasia is a word that was coined fairly recently in 2015 to describe people that have no visualization ability. So their mind is blind. We've known that people like this have existed for well over 100 years, but it wasn't until just recently that Adam Zeman, a neurologist, gave it this phrase, this term, coined aphantasia. And once that happened, it sort of took on its own momentum, and people really became fascinated with it as a condition. How does it affect, people's lives? Teachers, neurologists, doctors, therapists have all been asking how should what they do change if someone has or hasn't got imagery. Also, people have also been skeptical. People have been doubting that it's a real thing. So let me just sort of talk through some of the things we've done with aphantasia to really show, I think, that it is a real, I don't want to say condition or disability, because it's not that. I think it's part of the normal neurodiversity or diversity of mind, but I think it's a real thing, and hopefully you'll agree once you see these data. So the first thing we did is see if we could use this binocular rivalry illusion to try and show that aphantasia is a real thing. So we got people into the lab and we tested them using this binocular rivalry illusion method. And see in the red square here that the priming, this bias effect for people who said they had aphantasia, and they came, they reached out to us here in the lab, was just above 50, but really close to chance compared to a large group in the general population who on average typically have priming around 60. And you can do all kinds of simulations on that, looking at what is the probability of finding a group of people in the general population who all tend to sort of average around 50, and it's very, very low. In other words, it's quite a significant effect or a significant group. But here's another way of showing those data, where you see a nice general population there in that sort of bell curve and that red line showing the mean of where the group of individuals with aphantasia was. So this was the first clue that told us aphantasia is a real thing. It doesn't seem to be an effect of metacognition. In other words, not that imagery is still there and people are unconscious of it. It doesn't actually seem to be there when people attempt this attempt to create a visual image. So that was the first clue. Then we wanted to see if we could come up with a more physiological or more objective measure. So there's other data up there suggesting that the pupil responds to dark or bright light. So we want to see if dark or bright imagery also could drive imagery responses. And in that, if it could, how might that be different in individuals with aphantasia? So we use a paradigm like this. I know it's a little bit nerdy and sciencey, but just bear with me. So people are looking at a screen. And first, we show them where it says perception, 5 seconds there, going sort of from the top down, we show them a shape. We're using triangles here. See the shape, then they have a rest, and that's just imagine that shape. And we do either dark triangles or light triangles, right? Because we want to see how the eye responds. And we also manipulate the number of triangles, but we'll come back to that later. So we can look at the data just like this. So I know it's a lot on this slide, but you can see first going from left to right, in that perceptual condition, these two lines are far apart. So these two lines are showing the pupil, right, the diameter of my pupil, how constricted or dilated it is. You see that and lower on the graph is more constricted. In the bright condition, in perception, it's more constricted. And in the darker condition, of course, it's more open, it's more dilated. Interestingly here on the right in the imagery, you can also see that you see the same trend there. The effect is not as big because it's imagery, but clearly a difference there. Right, so you can see here in this zoom in that the blue is higher than the red, right? So for those with imagery, when you imagine a bright or a dark thing, your pupil is constricting when you imagine a bright thing, just like it is when you look at a bright thing. And there's sensible reasons for that happening in physiology. So here's the exciting or cool bit. What happens when people who come into the lab with aphantasia do the exact same experiment? Well, first up, in the perceptual part of the experiment, the two lines are separated again. So that looks pretty much the same. It's telling us that people with aphantasia have a normal pupil response to bright or dark images. Good to know. Here comes the imagery bit. When we get them to imagine the dark or light triangles, we don't see any difference. So let's zoom in here, right? I'm just showing you the single triangle condition here. There doesn't seem to be any effect of the bright versus the dark. So it's more evidence that even though these individuals are trying to imagine the dark and light triangles, the pupil is just not responding differentially. And interestingly, you might be thinking, well, maybe these people just don't try and imagine. They're just being lazy or tired or for whatever reason, they're not trying to imagine. And there's another effect that's pretty well documented that in cognition, the harder you're trying to do something, the more effort you put in, the wider the diameter of the eye. So what I'm showing you here is a lot of graph here, but all you need to really look at is the left and the right, the set size one and set size four. That's just the number of triangles. As there was more triangles, individuals with aphantasias pupils were less constricted. So that suggests that indeed they were trying to imagine, right? There's no effect of the bright versus the dark, but there's an effect of set size, which suggests they are trying, which we think helps us rule out the fact that they're just not trying, they're being lazy, or whatever it might be. So the next thing we wanted to try was looking at the relationship between thoughts and emotions. And the way we did this, we got people to come into the lab. We're going to do people with imagery and people without imagery. So both groups, sit them down in a dark room and we put these little wires on their fingers. And this is to measure skin conductance. This basically measures how much people sweat. So when you get scared or nervous, you sweat a lot more. And then how much your skin conducts changes quite quickly. So this is an easy way of like measuring how scared or aroused people are without having to put them in a brain scanner. So they're sitting in a dark room in front of a computer. We have the little electrodes on their fingers, and then they're going to read out scary stories on a computer monitor. And they go a little bit like this. Keep in mind, this is here in Australia. So you're in the water, the sun glints off the wave, suddenly a dark flash in the distant waves. Maybe it was a shadow. You turn to the beach, people are pointing and shouting. A large fin slices the surface of the water, moving closer and closer, a wide open mouth. Your legs flail before white teeth. Right, that's not the whole story. That's sort of an abbreviated version. But you see the gist, right? This is you're swimming and there's a shark comes up underneath you. So very scary. There are other version stories of rock climbing and different scenarios that involve fear and something sort of dangerous happening. So when people with imagery or the controls do this task here in the lab, we see this skin conductance, how much they sweat or their fear response goes up quite nicely like this. So the question is, what's going to happen if you have aphantasia? And we just don't see that response. We see pretty much a flat line for those with aphantasia. So they don't seem to be having the same physiological fear response to these scary stories. Oh, and there the average is just there, just sort of backing that up. That's quite, and that's a significant effect. So importantly, this could be due to imagery. It could be just due to different emotional systems, right? Maybe people with aphantasia are just not as emotional, so they're not responding as much. So we ran an important control condition where we show people images or photos of nasty, scary stimuli, right? And then do the same thing, measure their skin conductance. So the idea is here, there's no words, just pictures. So I don't need to imagine what the words say as the images are already on the screen. And we ran that experiment. We don't see any difference between those with aphantasia and those with imagery. The response is the same. So we know that individuals with aphantasia are having an appropriate emotional reaction, let's say, or fear response. It just seems that when you are reading scary stuff with words, you need images, you need mental images to link those words or thoughts with the emotional system in the same way. Right, so no imagery is kind of suggesting less emotional experience when reading these scenarios. And this taps in or supports many clinical theories that imagery is really important for emotion, that it's an important connector, if you like, between the emotional system and thoughts. And this is really the strongest evidence we've seen so far of that. So now just to sort of sum up, I hope this is starting to feel like that aphantasia is a real thing, right? That first we measure it with the VVIQ. I didn't really go into that, but when people do the VVIQ, which is a vividness of visual imagery questionnaire, their numbers are very different to someone with imagery. So I haven't gone into that. I skipped straight to the binocular rivalry results. So tick, the questionnaire data is very different. Binocular rivalry, that illusion data, very different. That lack of pupil response, very different in people with aphantasia as well, despite that set size effort effect that tells us that those individuals are trying to imagine, even though they don't seem to be able to. And also this lack of skin conductance, this lack of fear response through a lack of sweating, also suggesting that something real is happening with these individuals with aphantasia. So I think those four points really start to be convincing that something is going on here, that it's not just people, if you like, from a psychogenic or psychological perspective, are saying they don't have imagery. They really don't seem to have it. So next, I want to give a sort of broad brushstrokes overview of some of the experiments we've been doing on aphantasia and how things are the same or different across the spectrum of cognition. So here's a bit of data from a questionnaire study we published last year, and it's showing aphantasia and controls in the blue there across a range of different memory, episodic memory questionnaires. So that's questionnaires asking memory about my past history, my personal history, things I've been through, episodes. There's clearly large differences across most of all of those. Another question people ask is imagery purely visual? And the answer is it can be, but on average, no. So here's some data from a multi-sensory imagery questionnaire, and it's being graphed in this funny circular way. So as you move out in the circle, that's sort of higher scores on the graph. See, the red circle in the middle there is people with aphantasia, and the blue is controls with imagery. And straight away, it's obvious there's a big difference across all the different senses, right? Auditory, tactile, kinesthetic, taste. In particular, you'll see that sort of people are scoring almost zero for the aphantasia group in the visual quadrant. But on average, there's a difference across all the senses. So that's on average, right? When we look into the data, we see that some people have multi-sensory aphantasia, whereas other people will just have purely visual aphantasia. And in fact, there are other sort of groupings as well. Someone might have visual and auditory, or tactile, or just visual and auditory. And so there's sort of a spectrum of differences, if you like, in aphantasia. It's not always just purely visual. Another thing people are very interested in is dreams. How are dreams different for individuals without any imagery? Here's some data from a dream questionnaire, and you'll see that the biggest differences are really, as you might expect, in the sensory part of the dream questions. So, and you see the red and the blue lines are quite different there, saying that the individuals with aphantasia report the sensory characteristics of their dreams quite differently to the general population with imagery. So we've been studying visual working memory here in the lab for quite a few years now, and we've shown that if you have visual imagery, you'll tend to use it to help keep things in memory, right? If you have to remember a bunch of colored shapes, then me, someone with imagery, I'll try and imagine those shapes, and that helps sort of hold them in memory. So what happens if I don't have any imagery? Can I still do these memory tasks? Can I still perform well? So we ran a both sort of aphantasic and control with imagery groups in visual working memory tasks. And here's a little sort of diagram of what the tasks look like. We flash on these little circles with stripes in them, and they're different orientations. And if you're doing the task, your job is to remember where they were, but also the orientation of those stripes. And in this particular task, there can be one of those, three, four, five, or six. And then we randomly choose one of those locations to probe you at the end. So here's some data, and it's showing both the general population with imagery and aphantasic individuals in the gray there. And you'll see there's basically no difference. Both groups show this set size effect. Memory goes down with more and more objects, but there's no real difference in the two groups. We can do the same experiment with numbers, right? So exactly the same numbers around the circle. You have to remember those numbers. And then we test randomly one of those locations for that single number. And again, see a set size effect, but no difference. So no significant difference between those two groups. So it seems that in terms of if you just look at performance, then people are performing pretty much the same with or without imagery. If you ask about their memory strategy, which we did, and we have some data on that, people with aphantasia report having very different strategies. They don't use a visual strategy. They don't use imagery. They use geometry. They use symbols. They use words and ideas sometimes. All kinds of different strategies. There's no one strategy they all use. This is a different strategy. So this is, I think, a nice case where if you don't probe and look under the surface and see how people are doing a task like this short-term memory task, then it looks like everything's the same and everything's normal. But the strategy, and indeed, soon we'll see the brain areas are going to be different. So I would sort of say that people with aphantasia have adapted to not having imagery and just figured out a different strategy. They're compensating in a different way and they're achieving the same output, the same performance. So when they're in the field of mental imagery, there was a famous, very famous science paper, one of the top journals in science, on something called mental rotation. And this was a big deal back in the day, and it has been referenced so many thousands of times. So basically what they got people to do is show them these kind of cube-like shapes. You see one and you see the other, and your job is to say, are they the same? Is that the same shape rotated or a different shape? And when you get people to do that, here's the original data, the more of rotation in that object, the longer it takes people to answer those questions, right? And people took this as evidence of an objective, somewhat objective measure of mental imagery, that because it's taking more time, I'm imagining those squares and I can rotate them in my mind's eye. So we were wondering whether individuals with aphantasia could do a task like this. So we ran them in this exact task, again, control group and individuals with aphantasia. So are they going to get this sort of sloped classic, what's called mental rotation effect? And here in the red here, you see the aphantasic data. You see this really nice slope there. In other words, even without imagery, it takes individuals longer and longer to answer the questions, the larger the angle of rotation. So I think that's really interesting that whether you have imagery or not, you still show this classic mental rotation effect, right? So mental rotation does not mean, it's not the same thing as visual imagery. And there are lots of papers over the years that have used mental rotation tasks to measure imagery. So I think for all the imagery crowd listening, it's important to know that here's a case with individuals that don't have any visual imagery. They can't imagine what an object looks like, yet they're still able to do these mental rotation tasks. And they still show that sort of time versus rotation effect. And when you talk to individuals with aphantasia, they'll often say things like, I have a pretty good sense of space. I know where things are, even though I can't visualize or picture those things. And so it kind of makes sense that this is not really, this experiment, or this sort of tool, as a research tool, it's not tapping into visual imagery per se. It's more a spatial transformation task. You don't need to visualize the squares or whatever the thing is you're rotating. You just need to rotate space or points in space. So I mentioned episodic memory earlier on, and that's the memory of episodes of my life, right? What was my birthday like last year? Who was there? And how rich are those experiences? So we wanted to dig a little bit deeper beyond the questionnaires and see if other measures, other ways of measuring this could show more detailed differences, or maybe not, between imagery and aphantasia. So we use something called the autobiographical interview, an adapted version of that. And this is sort of, people have to have six memories in the past and six matched future events that haven't happened yet, but they'd like to. And then they write down as detailed as they can descriptions of those memories or future events. I need some details just to show you quickly. What I'm plotting here is internal details. You have past and future. And again, the two different colors, controls with imagery, and pink or red there for aphantasia. You'll see straight away there's a difference in the number of internal details. That if you're aphantasic, on average, again, all these data are pretty much on average, people are not recalling as many details. And you can sort of stretch this out over time. So looking at all the different time points, past and future, you'll see this difference sort of sustained across all of those time points. I think one there is not significant. So it seems that if you are aphantasic, your personal memories of your life, on average, again, are not going to be as detailed. So that's something that's really important. You'll hear me say on average, on average, on average, over and over. But it's important here because it doesn't mean that if you as an individual have aphantasia, that you will fit this mold. On average, the group data is showing these differences. But if you see some of the graphs with all the individual dots, and you'll see some more in a minute, there's a big distribution. And so it doesn't mean that any individual will have a poor episodic memory. And these effects are not catastrophic or huge. They're fairly small effects. It's not like if you don't have imagery, you won't be able to remember your past or anything like that. So we've been thinking, experimenting with thoughts in the brain. Where do thoughts come from? How do I control my thoughts? Can I even control my thoughts? And one of the interesting ways to tap into this is when you get people to say, don't think about a pink elephant, right? And straight away, if I tell you, don't think about a pink elephant, whatever you do, don't think about a pink elephant. And you just sit there trying not to think about it. It's very hard. Some people can do it, some people can't. But the elephant just, boom, pops into your head. So we wanted to see if there was a difference with or without imagery for this kind of task. So here's what this kind of task would look like. You sit down in front of a computer screen. We give you an object. Maybe it's a horse like this. And we say, do or don't think about the horse. And then you're 10 seconds. You're sitting there trying not to think about it, trying not to think about it. If you do think about it, you hit a button. Pops into your head again. You hit the button again. And then afterwards, you tell us what popped into your head. Was it the sound of the horse, the image, the concept, the semantics, or something else, the smell? And what we found is there was a significant difference between those with imagery and those without imagery. So I'm plotting here, showing you this graph is number of intrusions per trial. And people with imagery on average had a slightly higher number of intrusions. Again, it's not like double or triple, but it is significantly more intrusions. Now it seems, here's some sort of initial evidence that if you don't have imagery, it might be just a little bit easier to control those thoughts, not think about whatever you don't want to think about. Here's a breakdown just to show you, as you might be predicting, that if you are aphantasic, those intrusions you had were mostly abstract. This is this large orange bar there. If you have imagery, they're mostly images, right? The second group of bars along there. And you can also see those data in these pie plots here using a different color scheme. Sorry about that. But yeah, you'll see if you're aphantasic, then the majority of your intrusions were abstract, whereas if you had imagery, the majority or just over half were images. So I think that's really interesting that those with aphantasia might actually have better thought control. That's sort of particularly a silver lining. Now we're doing some follow-up experiments with this at the moment. This is fairly new data, trying to use our behavioral methods and that illusion, but not the rivalry, to measure these effects more objectively. And I think it's going to be interesting to put people in the scanner, the brain scanner, and see what's happening, what's causing these sort of this better and worse thought control. Somehow these images are just popping in there and stopping you from controlling your own mind. And this also sort of branches out to sort of disorders of anxiety and in general, the links again with thoughts, controlling thoughts and emotions. I think there's going to be a whole very rich and interesting field of research there, linking thoughts with or without images and emotions and the control of those thoughts and how that maps onto healthy behavior, healthy life, or disorders, disordered life. So I'll keep you posted there. So while we're on that topic, voluntary and involuntary images. So I mentioned dreams before. So dreams are an example where if you have dreams, then those images, those visual parts of your dreams are fairly involuntary. You're not trying hard to create those images. And indeed, when people have these thought intrusions, like in the last experiment, or if they have PTSD, or maybe they have a hallucination in Parkinson's or schizophrenia, they describe those sensory experiences as involuntary. They don't have control over them. So I'm also really interested in this relationship between voluntary and involuntary, right? So are the sensory experiences, if I involuntarily hallucinate the color red, is that more or less the same as me imagining, or is it totally different? And what can studying those two different scenarios tell us about imagery and about hallucinations and about aphantasia? Right, so I mentioned that, yeah, dreams, we saw some difference there. Again, when you dig a little bit deeper, you find some people with aphantasia have dreams, some don't, some have altered dreams, So again, there's a lot of individual differences there. So in the lab, we can do all kinds of tricky things to make you hallucinate, make you see different things. And one example of that is this illusion here. So if you're just sort of looking in the center there, you might start to see a little bit of red there, not the red elements in the circles, but in the middle there where it's otherwise black. So you might see a very faint shading of red. Then when I do this, maybe that goes away. So I'll go back again. Maybe you see some red there. So, throw up your hand, not that I can see, but throw up your hand if you saw that red. Let me go away again. So if you did, I'm basically making you hallucinate red where there's no red there. There's no red pixels on your screen, but you're seeing some red there. This is called the neon color spreading illusion. So we wanted to see if this, as an example of this involuntary imagery, would be the same, untouched, or different with individuals with aphantasia. So you had a paradigm like this where we'd show people the illusion, and then next to it, they had to slide, have a little slider and move up and down and adjust. There's a very faint square there of sort of pinky red, and then adjust that from nothing to very strong to try and match the color they saw right in the center there of that illusion. We also asked them, did you see red? We asked them subjective questions like that. So here's some data here from, again, controls in red this time and aphantasics in blue. And you'll see there's a sort of clear difference there on average again, that if you have imagery, you're reporting much stronger red color right in the center there. And these data here are from that adjustment task. And here's the subjective reports. We have just got people to give us a number, and it shows the exact same pattern. So I think that's really interesting. So some forms of involuntary imagery also seem to be affected in aphantasia, right? So dreams and illusions like this. We've started testing some other illusions now, and not all of them seem different in aphantasia. But this is diagnostic, I think, in terms of looking at what is different in the brain for individuals with aphantasia. If it was simply about the frontal cortex, it was simply top-down, right? Voluntary. Top down, how much effort I can put in, or how much control of my visual cortex I have, then involuntary versions like this shouldn't be affected. So they are affected. So it does suggest that something beyond that is going on. Something may be different in visual cortex as well. So I hope I've sort of started to convince you that imagery really is missing in aphantasia. It's not a case of poor metacognition or faking it, or it's not psychogenic, or it's not anything else. It does seem to be something fundamentally different in the mind and the brain of someone with aphantasia. So next, why is that so, and what is the mechanism there? So now we're trying to do extensive of our research looking at visual cortex anatomy and also visual cortex function. I haven't got time to go into that research now because it's a huge area. But we have evidence, as I mentioned briefly at the beginning, that in the general population, smaller visual cortex predicts stronger imagery, and quieter, that's right, quieter visual cortex also predicts stronger imagery. So we have ways of measuring, if you like, the excitability, how active those neurons are in visual cortex. And we can also make them quieter or make them noisier by running a very weak current through someone's visual cortex. So we've done that and we've published that. So it seems that you can manipulate imagery strength again in the general population. What we don't know is if you have no imagery to start off with, can we give you imagery? So that's where we want to take this line of research next. Not everyone who is aphantasic wants to have imagery. So that's an important thing. I think we'll need to combine brain stimulation with a training regime. The important caveat would be if you're going to do one of these experiments is if we give you imagery, we may not be able to take it away again. So anyone who is aphantasic and wants to take part in this kind of research has to think about it quite carefully, because they may not enjoy having imagery. We don't know what it's going to be like if you've spent your whole life not having imagery, and then all of a sudden you have imagery, or over a period of weeks, maybe you have imagery. So that's a really interesting case to think about. Again, I hope I've sort of given you guys the idea that imagery is not a disability. Sorry, aphantasia is not a disability by all means. It's not that at all. It's part of the general sort of diversity of neurology of the brain and of the mind. But it sort of brings up this interesting question: what is imagery? Right? If in general those with aphantasia get by pretty well without it, and we saw some of that those short-term memory data, performance exactly the same. What's the best way to think about the role of imagery? Right? It seems at once ubiquitous, and if you have it, you use it all the time. I have imagery and I use it all the time. But if I don't have it, I just come up with different strategies, different brain mechanisms of compensating or achieving similar outcomes. So I'd say that imagery is a tool that if you have it, you latch onto it and you use it. You mostly enjoy using it. If you don't have it, you latch onto other different kinds of tools. And really, so far in the research on aphantasia, in this sort of rebirth of imagery research of recent times, it's fairly young. So far, we know that there seems to be an important role for imagery, for images in the mind, connecting thoughts and emotions. You've seen some data that suggests that. So that is one of the areas going from thoughts to emotions, mind wandering, thought control, through to clinical anxiety and things like that, where I think there will be clear differences between someone with imagery and someone without. But otherwise, I don't think there are going to be a lot of differences. Another question for another day, but I'll quickly mention creativity. So a lot of people ask about creativity and the imagination, mental imagery. There are many artists who and entrepreneurs very successful who are aphantasic. It's not a disability. Okay. Pixar's one of Pixar's top animators who does these beautiful drawings is aphantasic. Okay. It's no barrier to being a visual artist. So more broadly, imagery, is the key to our internal private world, to our thoughts. I think it's the key to understanding visual perception as well, right? Vision is constructive. You want to understand the way we see the world. You also need to understand the way we imagine and our brain is creating that world internally all the time. It's also an interesting way to study consciousness. And over the last of 12 years, it's been amazing to see the change in people's interest in studying imagery. 12, 10 years ago, even, it was almost a taboo topic, and people would say it's too hard to measure. It's career suicide. Don't study imagery. Now it's much, much pop more popular. It's really sort of becoming a hot topic, right? So many have said it's too hard to study objectively and reliably. I think some of the data I've shown you today or tonight, this afternoon, suggests that's not the case. And I haven't even gone into the new cutting-edge fMRI machine learning data, which again backs that up really strongly. So, of course, I disagree with statements like that. I think we now can measure imagery reliably and objectively. So, I want to thank my university here, UNSW, here in Sydney, Future Minds Lab, my lab, the different Australian government agencies for funding this research. And, of course, hopefully, you guys are wide awake and enjoy the whole talk. So, thanking you for listening for this long.
Thanks, Joel, for interesting talk. I have some questions for you. First of all, how frequent is aphantasia? How many people are affected by this kind?
Yeah, great question. So it varies. There are a couple of studies looking from 2.5% up to about 5%. The interesting thing is, I think it's going to be higher. I think, I find people that don't know they're aphantasic until they see some media on it and they test themselves and they start reading about it. So just like color blindness, often people don't realize they're color blind until they're 20 or 30 or 40s even. So I think aphantasia is kind of going to be like that. So my prediction is it's probably going to end up being higher than 5%.
And this is a kind of phenomenon that works on the principle all or nothing, or could we indicate some kinds or subtypes of aphantasia or not?
Oh, definitely, yeah. So like I mentioned, when I was showing that sort of multi-sensory circular graph there, when you dig into those data, we see very quickly there's different types. So I think there's pure visual aphantasia, there's multi-sensory aphantasia. So that's having no if you like, mind's eye, or not being able to imagine any songs, any smells, any touch, anything. There's just nothing there. And then there's all sort of essentially all kinds of variations between those, or any sort of matching up of you know, auditory and visual, aphantasia, and all the other combinations you can imagine as well.
Okay, thanks. My next question is more general and maybe even more fundamental. In cognitive science, there is a long tradition of thinking about our mental processes in terms of manipulation on abstract, amodal symbols like Fodor's language of thought. How your studies on aphantasia and more general on imaginary looks toward this kind of thinking on mental processes? Or maybe in general, is there something like language of thought, according to you, or there is not something strange with that?
I mean, I think what the way you have to take this, all this research, is that it's not this, it's different, it's bespoke. And someone might think strongly in images, right? I haven't talked about hyperphantasia, people with very, very strong and vivid imagery. And that's at the other end of the spectrum. Or someone might think completely without images, just with semantics, concepts, space, and all those variations between, right? Maybe they can think in smells and touches, but not in without vision, without visual images. And so I just don't see how that you could make any statement about there being a universal language of thought when we know that so many thoughts are embodied, right? That simply our two groups here, when they read out these scary scenarios in a little dark room, their emotional responses are really different. And if you go onto discussion boards, you can see people with aphantasia discussing what it's like to read fiction. They talk about not enjoying fiction much and getting bored, so they stop reading. And it makes sense, right? If you don't have these graphic images popping up along with your thoughts, you know, as you're reading, then it's probably not going to be as enjoyable. So, yeah, I just don't see how you could make any strong statements when there, it's just this heterogeneous. There's so much variation in the language, if you like, of thought. It can clearly be symbolic. It can be geometric. It can be propositional. It can be depictive pictures in the brain. It can be across all the senses. It can be really embodied, and you can mix and match those and other things. And so, I don't really see the usefulness of trying to make a blanket statement that it has to be just this one thing.
Thanks a lot. And my next question concerns mental disorders. As we know, mental images could elicit very strongly emotions. And a lot of clinical picture of many mental disorders is focused on images like flashbacks in PTSD, for example. Could you say something more about this role of mental images in clinical picture and maybe in kinds of clinical interventions helping people with mental disorders? Could mental images or evoking mental images could be helpful for affected people or not?
Yeah, So one, when it comes to like disorders like PTSD, there's already some evidence suggesting that if you have more vivid and stronger imagery, there's a higher probability of you going on to get PTSD after experiencing a trauma. And we've branched out this sort of research I showed about, you know, thought control. We've now branched out. We're looking at paradigms of PTSD, and it does seem in early data that there is a difference there in these models of PTSD. If you don't have imagery at all, if you're aphantasic, things work very differently. So I can't really talk about those data yet. It's a bit early, but my prediction is that, yeah, if you like, a silver lining to being aphantasic would be that you're somewhat immune to developing PTSD. I don't think completely immune. And again, talking on average, so there are types of PTSD which don't involve images. They're rarer, but there are those types. And so someone with aphantasia could still get a version of PTSD. It just won't be the same, or won't have images. And then the sort of the second part of the question, yeah, we know that as a form of cognitive therapy, if you like, that imagery rescripting or imagined exposure are both commonly used methods in therapy. And if you don't have imagery, you can't do those, of course. So I think it's really important for therapists out there to check with their patients first, you know, do you have imagery or not? Because you can't really imagine a scenario and step through that bit by bit, re-script the trauma if you can't imagine anything. So yeah, I think measuring imagery is important for therapy, psychological therapy, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot. And my question is more scientific than practical, because
yeah.
Our audience consists also with scientists, students, and so on. And maybe some people, for instance, some master students, graduate students could listen to us. So how you screen people, participants, possible participants of your experiments for aphantasia? There is some prominent method for do it, or this is rather a chance?
No, so we tend, it depends on the studies, but we tend to have at least a two-pronged approach, and hopefully soon three-pronged. So if it's an online study, that's a different question, but when it's here in the lab, we'll first, people reach out to us and we add them to our aphantasia and hyperphantasia database. So if you do think you have those, go to futureminds.lab.com and you'll find the aphantasia page and sign up for the database. Then when they come in, we give them this questionnaire about visual imagery. Then we'll test them on the binocular rivalry thing, the method that I talked about, and see if they get priming. And then what we're also doing now is testing them on this pupil response. So what we're working towards is those three things together, or even just those first two, as being the sort of criteria for diagnosing, even though I don't like that word because it's not a disorder, but knowing someone has aphantasia. Because sometimes we do get people come into the lab who think they have aphantasia, but they do get priming. And so there's a mismatch there. Not very often, but it's happened a few times.
Mm-hmm. Thanks so much. Thanks, Joel, for your very interesting talk and for your answers. Thanks again.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure. It was great fun talking to you this evening, my time now. It's just getting dark here in, in Sydney. And I'm really sorry I can't be there for the festival, but I hope it's a lot of fun.
Thanks. See you, I hope, more physically in Krakow next time. Bye.
Oh, I look forward to it. Thank you.